Oh, buenos dias. I was just waiting for the Appalachian craftsman to arrive to finish working on the walls of my house. If you've ever had construction going on in your house, you know it can get really messy and disruptive. And I have a big gaping hole in my wall. But repairs to buildings go on all the time here at Mission San Luis. It's the only way that we can make sure that it stays in good condition. The repairs are necessary, or I wouldn't have a house. I'd love for you to stay so you can learn about the fascinating ways that the Spanish designer homes here at Mission San Luis. Oh, you'd like to stay? Great! Well, until the craftsmen arrive, why don't I tell you what I've learned from them about building my house here. Some Spanish settlers that arrived to La Florida decided to build our homes the same way that some of them were built back in Spain. Spaniards who'd been to La Florida for a while were aware of the native building techniques, like the ones you learned about last week. Remember how the Appalachian homes are round and had palm thatch on the roofs? Well, Spanish homes are different. Like the homes in Seville, Spain, the Spanish homes here at Mission San Luis are rectangular with small rooms, and they're painted with whitewash on the outside. But we did use a technique that we saw many Florida Indians using on their homes. We made some of the roofs of our buildings at Mission San Luis with palm thatch, just like they did. We also have spaces outdoors for certain activities, like cooking. What? You mean to tell me your kitchen isn't outdoors? How strange. Well, in Spanish homes here at Mission San Luis, we have a fire pit where the meals are prepped and cooked outside, a chicken coop where we keep our hens, and a garden area where we grow herbs and vegetables for meals. While some of the homes in Spain or St. Augustine might be bigger or more elaborate, the designs of most of the homes at Mission San Luis are more simple. They're square or rectangular with maybe one or two rooms. There's often just a wall in the middle of the home to divide the rooms. Most of the buildings are also just one story. Often, the way families show wealth here is not by having large homes, but by having beautiful things inside the homes. Majolica from Mexico, or even pottery that came all the way from China. We also have beautifully built furniture from craftsmen in Spain or Mexico. Nice furniture takes money and materials to make, so it's an important part of making a nice home. So let's get to the interesting part. How is my home constructed? I've learned a lot from the Appalachian builders who are repairing it. My home is constructed with strong wooden posts that make the frame of the walls, and then the main part of the walls are made by using a special technique called Wattle and Daub. Wattle and Daub is a fascinating building technique that is used in many places all over the world to build homes and walls. And this is the material that the Spanish settlers here at Mission San Luis made their buildings from. So what is Wattle and Daub exactly? First, we should talk about wattle. After the large wooden posts are raised to make the main structure of the house, the wattle makes the frame of the walls. This forms the basic structure of the house. The wattle frames can be made from many different materials, like mulberry branches or young yaupon holly branches, thick woody vines like muscadine grapevines, or reeds like cane. The branches need to be cut fresh and green so that they will bend well. If we use branches from trees that have fallen to the ground, they would be too brittle and would break. We need them to bend because they weave the branches together between large posts. As long as the branches are cut fresh and bend well without snapping, they'll make great wattle. So the builders weave the branches into a sturdy shape between strong wooden posts. This makes the basic frame of the wall. But I couldn't just live in a house made of woven sticks. The wind, rain, and small animals might get in. We need something to cover the holes in the sticks. So this is where daub comes in. Once the wattle frame is constructed, now we need to make our daub. Daub is a mixture of natural materials and acts like a plaster. So, what is it made of? We need three main ingredients to make daub. First, we need are clay. Clay acts like a binder. The clay is dug near the home, in fact, just behind the house, in what is called a clay mine or a clay pit. Then we need some sort of sand or perhaps crushed stone, and this acts as a sturdy material to add to the mixture to reinforce the entire structure once it's dry. Finally, we need some sort of grass or straw, and in the case of some homes at Mission San Luis, Spanish moss, which you might see growing on trees outside your home. The grass or the moss also helps to strengthen everything and keep it together in the wall, making it strong against any impact like falling tree limbs or hurricane force winds or tree limbs falling because of hurricane force winds. The builders mix all the ingredients very well into a daub pit and then is applied in thick amounts to the wattle frame. Once you press the daub into the woven sticks, it stays firmly. The daub that covers the wattle eventually dries and becomes very hard and sturdy. Now, what is done once the wattle and daub are put up? Well, in the classic Spanish style, the wattle and daub is painted over with a whitewash, or sometimes called a lime wash. This white paint is made of ground limestone, hence called lime wash. It can also be made of ground and powdered oyster shells. The limestone or oyster shells are heated very hot and then crushed into a powder to create the whitewash. Why would the color of your house matter other than to make it look good? Well, the whitewash is important in the heat of La Florida, where just like in Spain, it also gets very hot in the middle of the summer. Painting your house white makes it so that the sunlight reflects off the walls so it can stay cooler inside the home. Isn't that smart? Even the walls of the blockhouse at our fort are whitewashed. Speaking of forts, have you ever been to the fort at St. Augustine, way on the other side of Florida on the east coast? The fort is called the Castillo de San Marcos, or the San Marcos Fort. You've probably heard the merchant speak about it. The fort was completed not long ago in 1695, or was it 1696? I'm pretty sure it was 1695. Anyway, it was just finished being built a short time ago, and it was built out of a really interesting material from the local environment. Do you know what it is? It's a natural stone, but it's not made out of rocks. It's made out of seashells. This amazing stone is called coquina, and it's incredibly strong. The coquina stones formed from layers and layers of tiny shells you've probably seen on the beaches in Florida. When the shells harden together over time with sand, it makes very strong rock. Now, the name coquina is actually from the Spanish word for cockle, which means clam or like a scallop. The coquina shells are mostly very small though, not even an inch long, and some as tiny as a fingernail. The stone was brought from Anastasia Island, about a mile from St. Augustine. This is where the vast majority of coquina was quarried, or cut, to build the fort. Now, for many years, the Spanish were building wooden forts, just like ours here, but they kept getting destroyed until 1668, when an English pirate attacked the fort and burnt the city of St. Augustine to the ground. This is when they realized wooden forts, yeah, they're definitely not working well for some places. Construction of a masonry or stone fort was begun soon after this to protect the city of St. Augustine from another attack. You know, just last year, in November of 1702, the English attacked the fort of St. Augustine again. The fleet of ships from the Carolina colony of Charlestown sailed into the Matanzas River. They began to attack the fort, firing cannons and shooting muskets, and they did this for 2 whole months. Can you believe it? And then do you know what? The walls of the fort held up,
And the fort was not taken by the English. The walls didn't splinter, and they didn't even crack, and they certainly didn't collapse. Probably the main reason that the fort walls didn't crumble under 2 months' worth of cannon fire is because of the material the Spanish used to build the fort. If the walls had been built out of, let's say, sandstone, the walls would have turned to dust and rubble under the cannon fire in a very short time. The coquina absorbed the force of the cannon fire. But coquina was actually the only stone building material in the area to use, so I think it worked out well. And if it weren't for coquina, the English might have control over La Florida right now. I know I have a really special place in my heart for all those tiny seashells that make up the walls of the fort at St. Augustine. So here's to the seashells.